all very much for coming again. This is now the fifth lecture that we've had together. Fifth lecture. So I'm very grateful for the chance to talk to you. And because all of these ideas are not, they're not written down, I think, in a coherent way. And so when I try to put these things together, I do a lot of work to try and understand it better myself. So in some sense, you give me an excuse to understand what I'm doing much better. So I'm very grateful. The three lectures today on emergence are the ones I think that are most close to my heart. Are the ones that are most close to my heart in understanding complex systems and the kinds of systems that I've worked on in the past. There, I think emergence is a vast topic. It's sometimes given a somewhat mysterious aura because it comes up at the end of something else. But we're going to focus today on emergence itself as a scientific concept. And I think the key message here is that even though people say, oh, consciousness is emergent, it's an emergent phenomenon, people say, oh, social systems are emergent, and it's left somewhat up in the air, that there is, in fact, a whole body of theory that largely comes out of the physicist's toolbox that allows you to talk about the kinds of things you think you want to talk about when you see an emergent system. Can we turn down the volume on the... Thank you very much, JP. We don't have a pointer. I guess my... No, it's okay. Thank you, though. So the three sort of central concepts, I think, are universality. In the second lecture, we'll talk about how to apply notions of universality and the associated concepts of renormalization and coarse graining to inhomogeneous and information processing systems. So this is somewhat a known body of work. This is much less known. It's something that many of us in the Institute are interested in developing. In the final lecture, we'll talk about the sort of non-equilibrium aspects of emergence. We'll talk about phase transitions and critical phenomena, and we'll talk in particular about symmetry breaking. So this is a sort of linear path through a constellation of concepts. I'm going to pick a particular path through it. I'd really be grateful if, having seen these three lectures, if you're not completely confused by the end, if you have thoughts about how to structure this set of topics, please do email me. So today we'll talk about universality, which is a very mysterious and beautiful phenomenon. And we'll talk about the associated concepts of renormalization, which we get from the physicists, and coarse graining, which is the concept that underlies renormalization. As I mentioned, emergence is itself somewhat mysterious at first glance, but I think reasoning about emergent phenomena correctly is a central feature of modern science. It's not only a set of beautiful mathematics, and not only a set of empirical results that have a generality that can be quite stunning, but it's also an interesting account of how to do science. It's, in some sense, making a certain philosophy of science explicit. And so I'll start there with what we want when we want explanations in a scientific theory. So here's one account of what it means to do science, right? So you might be a psychologist, and you have a fine-grained theory of people's motivations, why people do what they do. You may, for example, have an a priori theory about certain kinds of motivations, and you make some measurements on people, and you calibrate the parameters of your psychological theory. This, in some sense, is all about statistical estimation, which is something we covered in the previous three lectures. So you have some fine-grained theory, okay, with some free parameters that you measure in the laboratory, let us hope, okay? Let us hope you have good enough data to measure it in the laboratory. You could try and extract it from some sort of non-intervention experiment if you like. Given that fine-grained theory, you then do a simulation. Okay? You have a large computer, and you build an agent-based model. I know Sandra will think about lattice QCD as an example, where you have some complicated set of interactions that you can't solve exactly. Okay? You may have an exact psychological theory with a set of equations relating different kinds of desires, but you don't know what happens when you aggregate that set of people. So you take somebody whose psychology you know or can calibrate, take someone else whose psychology you know or can calibrate, how do they interact? Okay? And in general, how do crowds of those people interact? And so to get from the fine-grained theory to a full prediction about the aggregate phenomenon, you do a simulation. So that's certainly one thing that you can do. I'm going to tell you a different way to do science. You have your fine-grained theory. You do something that we'll call coarse-graining. So you aggregate the individual variables in such a way that you produce a description of the full system that's imprecise in some crucial way. So all of us have a set of psychological states that are unique, presumably, and beautiful and complicated, and you can spend years in therapy. But when I come to describe the global psychological state of this room, I'm going to aggregate over all your neuroses and joys in such a way that I produce a coarse-grained description of the state of the room. Okay? And in some sense, being good at science is knowing the right coarse-grained description. Of course, I don't have to do that. Okay? If I have a big enough computer and a good enough base psychological theory, I can just simulate all of you individually and all of your interactions. Okay? But we're not going to do that. We're going to coarse-grain you. Okay? And the idea is that that theory that you come up with by the coarse-graining operation allows you to explain the phenomena that you see, not just predict it. Okay? Not just predict why, for example, this room might turn ugly, might riot. Not just predict the circumstances under which that happens, but explain why it happens. And so that's the goal I think we have here. Let me give you an example from a wonderful book by Bob Batterman, who's a philosopher of science at the University of Pittsburgh, who used to be a condensed matter physicist. So there's something called the Euler critical point, where, and I strut here. So I place my hand on top of this page. So that, imagine this is holding up a ceiling, let's say. And as I load this ceiling increasingly, I reach a point where it buckles. Okay, in this case, it buckled to the left, my left. How do we explain what you just saw? Okay, how do we explain that particular, buckle to the right. How do you explain that particular phenomenon? Okay? Well, one thing you can do is you can, you know, buy a very expensive computer, right? And simulate every single molecule in this folder. Okay? All the air molecules, all the vibrations in my hand, right? All indeed my psychological state describing how hard I'm going to push as I try to make this point. Okay? And not only will you predict it buckles, but you may even, if you're lucky and good enough with statistics, predict exactly the direction it will buckle in, the violence with which it buckles. Okay? You may find that huge simulation not only tedious to do, but also somewhat unsatisfying as a scientist. And I think what you may instead try to do is realize that this process here of loading a symmetric system, loading a system where it can buckle to the left or the right, okay, to such a point that all of a sudden it goes into a new state. Some coarse-grained description of that system might be preferable, because your intuition is that if this buckles, it's somewhat similar to, say, the columns in this room buckling, right? If the ceiling is overloaded with snow, let's say. And let's hope that won't be the case, although it is summer. So not only, for example, might you be able to explain why, well, yes, paper buckles, but so does, you know, iron. Iron also buckles under loads, under vertical loads. But you may even be able to extend your theory to analogous cases. So this is here, the exact same phenomenon where the load, so these are railroad tracks and you can see they buckle. The load that's caused that bending is not actually a physical force, but the expansion of the railroad tracks under heat. Okay? So that's the goal that you have in describing what you might call the emergent phenomenon of buckling. This is an account that, in some sense, in a far less quantitative way, has been a goal, I think, of the social sciences, although I'm not sure what postmodernism did for this goal. But the idea is that there are universal social phenomena that are somewhat independent, okay, of the details of the system. right? So is this like this, right? Now, the accounts, and I guess I'm treading on dangerous ground here because I don't know the philosophy of the social sciences. One account might be to say the reason that these two phenomena are similar, right? Tahrir Square and the French Revolution, the reason that these phenomena are the same is because the underlying mechanisms are identical. That's one way to tell the story, right? It says, you know, people are fundamentally the same. They have certain desires and needs, and when they're not met, the liberal subject revolts. Okay? That's one account, but it's not necessarily the only account. And one thing we'll see in these lectures is that, in fact, the mechanisms can be very different. Okay? Egyptians and, you know, 18th century Frenchmen can actually be very different kinds of people. They can have very different ways to interact, and yet you can still talk about the potential for universal phenomena in social and biological systems. So just to be clear, I'm not saying that these are examples of universal phenomena. I'll give you clear and reliable examples of universal phenomena that maybe aren't as sexy as these, but I hope you'll bear with me. So here are three crucial concepts for the lectures. Coarse-graining. How do we simplify the system by aggregating the parts together? How do we reduce, right, the 10 to the 26 states of all the atoms in this piece of paper? How do we reduce that down in such a way that we can look at an iron bar and look at the reduced description of that system and see that they're the same? Okay, so that's the coarse-graining question. The next concept is the concept of effective theory, which is something that gets talked about quite a bit. If you're a physicist, you know what an effective field theory is. But the idea is, after you coarse-grain the system, what is the new description of the system? What is the new set of equations that govern it? Okay? And finally, there's a concept of the basin of attraction. Okay? The basin of attraction is what mechanistic stories coarse-grain to the same effective theory. Okay? So we'll give explicit examples, but I'd like to begin with perhaps it's funny to think of this as a emergent phenomenon or a universal phenomenon, but it actually is. Do people know the central limit theorem? Are they familiar with it? Right? It's why everything's a Gaussian, right? It's why you can talk about the variance in the system and feel like you've described it all. Okay? So here is a formal statement. We won't prove the central limit theorem. There's many ways to prove it. They won't take us into mathematics that would be useful in this case. But if you're interested, I urge you to Google it because proofs are legion. But the idea is that the distribution of a sum of independent variables, as long as that underlying distribution has a finite variance, tends towards the Gaussian. So let's use the concepts that we had on the previous slide. Effective theory, okay? The effective theory here is the Gaussian distribution. That's going to be what describes our system when we've coarse-grained it sufficiently. Okay? What is the coarse-graining operation? How are we aggregating everything together? Okay? We're just taking averages or sums. Okay? So we're not even considering any spatial structure that might be found within the system. We're just saying every observation is independent. I have a big list of them. I'm just going to add the whole list together and take the mean. Okay? And finally, what class of objects? What's the basin of attraction? Okay? Anything where the elements of the system, what you're measuring, okay, is independent. So let me draw this up on the board here. Okay? Here's a theory of a distribution that you're drawing from. So this is some complicated thing here, right? The probability of having any particular value is some discontinuous function. Okay? If I aggregate that function enough, I flow, usually pretty fast, towards the limiting distribution, the Gaussian distribution, okay? Even if I have a distribution that has support only on a finite number of locations, such as coin tossing, if I average the answers of a coin toss, right, let's say heads is 0 and tails is 1, if I average this enough, I also get to the Gaussian, right? So all of these theories of how you might draw from a distribution look the same when you aggregate sufficiently. This looks different from this. Under coarse graining, they flow to the same place. There's a boundary line. Some theories do not coarse-grain to the Gaussian. Okay? In particular, theories that do not have finite variance, which include many power law distributions. Okay? So if you coarse-grain them, they go off somewhere else. And there's some sort of dividing line between these two kinds of theories, right? Let me draw a circle around all these theories in terms of their underlying mechanism. And what I'll say the underlying mechanism is the same. There's no interaction between the particles, okay? What that means is that there are other theories that make coarse grains in different distributions, in particular, theories that have mechanisms that produce persistent correlations. Okay? So the central limit theorem is an example of not only the construction of an effective theory, not only an example of coarse graining, but also a story about the basin of attraction theory. Okay? Let me tell you a little story. This is a popular story that's told every time the market crashes about the central limit theorem. Say for some reason that will become apparent, you want to predict the value of a portfolio of goods over time. So you know the value, let's say, at time t, and you want to know how that value evolves from time t to t plus 1 to t plus 2. In general, you earn interest, you have some rate of return that's multiplicative. So the portfolio at time t plus 1 is some rate alpha, let's call it, at time t plus 1 multiplied by your portfolio at the earlier time. And two time steps away is the product of alpha at those two different times, and so on and so forth. Okay? Let us say we have an underlying mechanism for the behavior of financial markets. Let us say that that alpha is drawn from some distribution. I don't care which one. It could be some really bizarre one, okay? As long as it has a finite variance, okay? Then the log of the changes in your portfolio are driven by the sum of random variables, okay? By the central limit theorem, all of the details of your financial theory coarse grain away, okay? And only the variance matters. Okay? So that's the argument. It's a very simplified argument where here's a space of mechanisms. Here are the variance infinite mechanisms. Here are the finite variance mechanisms. And here are the correlated systems. As long as your theory of the financial markets falls anywhere in here, okay, if you coarse grain enough, you will eventually get to the Gaussian distribution. Okay? So that effective theory of the markets is the basis of Black-Scholes, how people try to price or determine the value of an option on a portfolio. You have to estimate the fluctuations and how they might affect the value, and then in order to estimate the value of a derivative that's predicated on that portfolio. So, as you know, Black-Scholes has a bad reputation, right? So, people will tell you it was responsible for one of the first big bailouts we had, which was the failure of long-term capital management. But it sort of comes up every time. So this is an article this year from The Observer, right? The mathematical equation that caused the banks to crash. Okay? So, what went wrong with our effective theory of financial markets? Sorry? They assumed independence. That's a good answer. Here are two other answers, but we'll get to your answer later because I think that's probably the best answer for this lecture. So, okay, Mandelbrot, who you know because he's on your dorm wall in college, the inventor of the Mandelbrot set and one of the popularizers of fractal distributions, Mandelbrot would say, oh, aha, that's fine. You're placing your underlying mechanism puts you in this part of the space. It puts you in the landscape of theories where the variance is not finite, where there are fat tails to the distribution. And so if you coarse grain here, you don't get to the Gaussian distribution. You go off into some terrifying part of space that may work for a while, but eventually it's going to kill you. Okay? So, I don't know what it means to have a physical distribution whose variance is infinite. Every time I compute something in the spreadsheet, I always get a finite answer as long as I don't divide by zero. So, when Mandelbrot, another way to put it is that every power law probably has an exponential cutoff at some point, right? You can't have the market lose more value than exists on the planet Earth, right? So, really, what he said of the variance of alpha is not finite, really the convergence to the Gaussian is too slow. That's what he really means. Because the space of possible theories of finance all have finite variance, but they might coarse grain here too slow. Okay? So that's Mandelbrot versus Black-Scholes. Here's the sage of Omaha, Warren Buffett, in his report in 2008 to the shareholders of his unbelievably successful company, Berkshire Hathaway. So his claim is not that the underlying financial system has infinite variance, which I think is reasonable, but rather that our knowledge of the variance is limited. Okay? And so he gives the example here of trying to price the value of a portfolio over 100 years, which essentially you're being asked to predict the spread of values of the stock market in 100 years' time. Well, how do you estimate that variance? Right? And so he compares this example and says, you want to know what the value of your farm is going to be, and every day some crazy guy comes up to you and offers you a different amount for it, which is his description of the variance of the stock market on short time scales. So I'll put this on the reading list. It's actually a very nice, very practical description of how effective theories sort of scale or go wrong when you come to talk about social systems. Okay. So we know the Gaussian tends to work, right? We all use it. And in general, we find it's a useful way to describe things that are independent. But let me give you an example of a system where the variables are not drawn independently, where there's some kind of collective effect. And what I'll show you is that when you coarse grain that system, you'll go to a different distribution from the Gaussian. Not because the variance is infinity, not because the underlying mechanism has some unbelievably fat tail, right? And not necessarily because the system is non-stationary, which is Warren Buffett's claim. Warren Buffett, though, is saying, he's not saying that it's necessarily that draws from the stock market are not independent, just that the variance on different timescales changes. Okay? And in fact, people who price the Black-Scholes, they know this. It's called the volatility smile. Right? So you actually kind of put in this little hand crank correction. So even people who actually have to make money know this. So let me give you an example of a system that I find particularly interesting, partly because it's changing the world, and that is the open source software movement. So I'll show you data from 10 years of software projects on one of the most popular websites called SourceForge. So you probably use SourceForge to download various kinds of software packages. And what SourceForge is an archive for people to not only put the sort of binary files, but also the source code as well, right? Which is one of the sort of commitments of the open source movement. Okay. So what I plotted here, and this should be familiar from John Hart's talk, what I plotted here is the number of software projects that you find, up to about 20,000, okay, that use different languages, and I've just ranked them. I've ranked them by word. So you can see the most popular software language in SourceForge over the last 10 years was Java. Okay. Sadly, Ruby, which I love very much, is somewhere down here. Okay. This is also probably a good way to figure out which language to learn, right? Python. Python is up here. Okay. And you can see, right, you go all the way down. Fortran, sadly, is not doing so well these days. Haskell has elegance. Turing, sadly, programming language named after the inventor of programming, has only two projects in the entire system, in the entire database. So let's look at that distribution, and let's say, well, what if this was the following underlying mechanism, right? I wake up in the morning, I look at all the languages, I say, which ones are the best, and I draw one at random from some distribution, okay? By the central limit theorem, when you aggregate 20,000 such decisions, you should get a Gaussian distribution. So let me plot what the Gaussian distribution looks like overlaid on top of the actual distribution. Okay. So those are the 1 and 2 sigma contours, and the dashed line is the median, okay, of what the system would be if it were actually governed by independent, identically distributed draws from the possible languages. What you actually find is a very different distribution. You find a log-normal distribution. And in fact, I had a nice conversation with John Hart about this, because this is, of course, very similar to the discussion of species abundance rank, or SAR. And in fact, if you actually do the model selection on this, if we talked about in the statistics lectures, you actually do the model selection, you find actually the Fisher log series is actually preferred. under both the AIC and DIC. You remember those. And why, even though in these sort of mesoscopic range here, the intermediate popular languages, things like Ruby and Fortran, even though the Fisher log series does poorly, it overpredicts their abundances. Okay? It actually does well enough at the very highest rank that it beats out the log normal. Why does it beat out the log normal? Well, I think the answer is a Warren Buffett answer, which is when you look at those really popular languages, you see these long-term trends in their use. So the distribution of C language programs is not stationary over time. Okay? But if you go back and just look at the lower rank languages, so everything in this case it turns out below rank 7, that's where the log-normal distribution is. Okay? So let's just review where we have the central limit theorem, which is aggregation by adding. You believe that the mechanism is independent of what the last person did, okay? And then we have the open source language dynamics, which leads to a different limiting distribution, okay? And the question is this, how do we aggregate? Okay? Another way to put it is, do we have a theory? Okay? There's some underlying mechanism, okay, that's discussing why a single person chooses a language, how that language choice is influenced by the choice of people around him, how that choice is influenced by groups of people, all the way up to the largest possible scales of 10 years of open source software. And the answer is we don't actually have a theory. All we know is that the limit of that theory, when you go from individuals and scale them all the way up to groups, is this log-normal distribution. So let me put up now a space, just as I did before, a space of possible mechanisms, okay? And whatever, I call this the third generation open source movement for reasons that will become apparent in a second. Whatever mechanism underlies language choice in the open source movement on sufficiently large scales, coarse grains for log-normal distribution, okay? So here's another basis of interaction that we talked about already, the boring old Gaussians, right? The finite variance distributions. But aggregate independently. Okay? Another thing that falls under the log-normal distributions is the set of mechanisms that underlie how people choose to learn or are forced to learn or are born into speaking a human language. Okay? So presumably the reason that you choose a programming language is very different from the reason you choose to speak a language you speak, or the multiple languages you speak. Okay? So two very different kinds of mechanisms. They happen at different ages, right? You learn your first programming language probably when you're in your teens or your 20s. I don't know. I hope so. I hope we don't learn it younger. But somehow, those two mechanisms, okay, very different, right? As different potentially as Egyptians in Tahrir Square and Frenchmen in Paris, right? Coarse grain to the same universal class. Okay? So I've just put up the one of many papers describing the log-normal distribution. So I haven't done that analysis myself. We know another class that John Hart talked about, which is the Fisher log series distribution for species area relationships and species abundance distributions. Okay? Somehow, the underlying mechanisms that lead to the growth of pine trees on the side of a mountain, right, cockroaches in your basement, right, all of those different kinds of ecological dynamics, all of them coarse grain on sufficiently large scales to the Fisher log series, and in particular to the set of maxent distributions that John talked about. Okay? So we're already getting a sense of basins of attraction, okay, and universality classes. Okay? So these mechanisms here all belong, you might say, to the same class. Let me put another one in. This is a picture of a mechanism that's postulated to underlie the development of insurgency in different modern conflicts. Okay, so you can see here, right, there's insurgent groups of different sizes, they all decide whether to make attacks, there's some kind of broadcast of news, so they update their strategies. Some complicated set of mechanisms there, okay? And what these guys did, and by these guys, I mean Bohorquez et al. In a recent paper in Science, what these guys did is they showed that that mechanism, right, this general class of mechanism here, okay, coarse grains, to some limiting set of distributions. Okay. Now, to be clear, they didn't actually go and construct an effective theory. Okay? They actually took that kind of detour through simulation. So they constructed a lower-level mechanism, okay? And instead of coarse-graining it, as we'll try and do today, instead of coarse-graining the mechanism explicitly to see what emergent variables arise, they actually just simulated it and hammered the statistics in order to get the fits. Okay? But the idea is that this space of mechanisms here, okay, coarse-grained in fact two potential cases. They showed that, for example, the insurgency in Afghanistan, the insurgency in Iraq, and the insurgency in Peru, all coarse-grained to this green distribution here. I'm not sure if they gave it a name, but it's theirs. Okay. But other kinds of insurgencies, presumably because they lie in a different part of parameter space, same mechanism, different parameters, they actually coarse-grain to a log normal distribution. Okay. So in this case, if you look at the distribution of attacks in the Spanish Civil War, and particularly in the mortality of those attacks, you find the Spanish Civil War is actually in the same universality class as human language choice. Let me take another step. SourceForge is now getting a bit old. In fact, if you actually look the number of downloads people make from SourceForge, it's not doing as well. It's not on that exponential Moore's law kind of curve anymore. And why is that? Well, the idea is that open source is changing. And in fact, it's becoming easier to modify projects. The idea of having a monolithic, gigantic open source project is becoming less popular. What's becoming more popular are open source projects that are smaller in scale, okay? That they're easier to fork, right? It's easier to take somebody else's open source code and say, you know what, I can do this differently, I have different goals, so I'm gonna fork it, right? And different kinds of websites have emerged, in particular GitHub now, is one of the canonical places where you go if you're this kind of programmer, okay? If you're in this sort of extreme programming, rapid iteration world. So from SourceForge to GitHub, and you know GitHub is more modern because look at these cartoons, right? And it says be social, right? You know, SourceForge never told you to be social. The question is are the underlying parameters of the open source movement such that when you coarse grain what you might call the fourth generation of open source, the GitHub open source, will that go to a different limiting distribution? Instead of going to the log normal, will it perhaps go to this decentralized insurgency model? Okay. So those are the kinds of questions the universality allows you to ask, right? It allows you to talk about mechanisms, the limits of mechanisms, and how different distributions can be obtained, either because you change the mechanism or because you change the underlying parameters. Okay. Somehow, there's some sociality parameter in source forge that's too low. Okay. So we'll make that more explicit in a second. So here's where we've gotten so far. We'd like to talk about aggregate predictions. We'd like to talk about why something buckles, the statistics of buckling, let's say. Okay. One thing we can do is begin with a fine-grained theory, okay, and simulate it. So for example, in order to generate the distributions that fit so well for the Iraqi insurgency and the Afghanistan insurgency, that's exactly what they did. They fit small-scale measurements to the fine-grained theory, simulated an outcome, these wonderful limiting distributions. What we'd like to do instead is figure out a way to determine how this theory changes as you aggregate on increasing larger and larger scales. And I guess to follow that point, we've been so far rather sketchy about what it means to aggregate. I've only given you one explicit example of aggregation, and that's simple addition, where you take all your data and you simply take the average. You have no other way to say, well, I'm going to average these things over here to get one number and these things over there to get another number, right? I've given you no explicit example of that, and I will in a second. What we've been able to do, though, is we've been able to see how systems themselves can coarse-grain just by measuring aggregate parameters and seeing that they have the same limiting distributions. So we don't have an explanation for why open source goes to the log normal. We can just observe that it does, and that gives us hints, perhaps, about the underlying mechanisms. Yes, Chris.
How do you know, you can aggregate all you want, but there should be some level of stuff. If there is such a thing as too much of coarse-graining, is there, or?
You have parameters of interest. You have things that you want to understand. And if you want to understand, for example, let's go back to the open source software example. So, the question is, what do you want to explain in this system here? Do you want to explain why Java, C++, and C have the ordering that they do? Right. You might, right? It might be an interesting question. In fact, I think the answer is quite interesting. The reason is that when people invented C++, it was such a terrible language for object-oriented programming and consensus couldn't form. So you can tell those kinds of narratives, right? But you may also want to explain why is there this overall structure to the system? And you're going to get a better and better answer as you coarse-grain, because a lot of the underlying details of the mechanism will disappear, the details that you don't care about. Right? The details of why sort of Haskell has the position it does because someone at Google said it was a cool language to use, for example. Those kinds of distributional things will wash out. So, but it's an excellent question. Yes, John?
So I'm trying to connect your initial example with the strut and how that applies to a large range of phenomena, rail ties, etc. Mm-hmm. And this idea of looking at how the system falls into this space of limiting distributions. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I look at that piece of paper and I go, oh, it works this way, and then I look at some the walls here. Mm-hmm. There's a sense in which I'm mentally kind of coarse-grained and seeing an analogy between these two where the rules seem applicable. Mm-hmm. But now if I were to not do that process and instead look at the walls through some level of description of the composition of it, the heat properties, and then map it onto some limiting space, mm-hmm. how is that going to then get me to this state where I feel like, oh, this is a strut where I can apply the same rules? How do we go from seeing, oh, these end up in the same limiting distribution to then seeing some kind of common set of mechanisms that make that aggregation meaningful?
So that's a very good question. Let me give you a preview of the answer, but it's something, so the strut example is, I think, the most advanced example, and by the end of lecture 3, we'll have all the pieces in place. But let me give you a story, okay? You have a set of mechanisms. All of these mechanisms coarse-grain to a limiting distribution, which you might call symmetry left. Okay? So you have a whole set of mechanisms, and they all coarse-grain to a state that you say has broken a left-right symmetry. Okay? So for example, right? In that case, from your point of view, it coarse-grained to the symmetry left case. All of these systems here coarse-grained to a final distribution that's symmetry-breaking right. Okay? So these are not particularly interesting limiting distributions, right? But what happens when you're very close to this critical point? What happens when the system is reasonably symmetric, right? It's essentially a straight line, and it can coarse-grain either to the left breaking or the right breaking mode. Okay, that process there is universal, and that's where you find a set of descriptions that apply just as well to a piece of paper, right? Where you know what the symmetry right and symmetry left states are to the railroad tracks, which again have that same symmetry breaking. So that's how to connect, but so far has been a picture without any notion of aggregation. We haven't told people how to aggregate yet, right? But that's going to be the story that we get at the end.
So you're saying that by choosing to coarse grain, you're getting something about the bigger picture, but we are missing out on where this theory is applicable. It's somewhere applicable closer to some transition, closer to some change. So that's the price we're paying to somehow coarse grain and get bigger.
So this picture here, which is a symmetry breaking transition, is different from the central limit theorem. In the central limit theorem, every distribution progresses towards the Gaussian, right? There's no sort of critical point. I mean, you can look at the critical point of distributions that if they decrease slightly faster than finite variance, go to the Gaussian, and you know, if they decrease too slowly, go, yeah, exactly, they go off to some wild space. So, does that answer your question?
No, I was just thinking, is this the price we're paying so to coarse grain? That was the main question.
The price you might be paying is that the variables that you're using to describe the system. So for example, let's go back to the Gaussian case, right? So I'm going to draw here a space of distributions, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to tell you the variance and the skew. Okay? So this is the variance. Okay? And this is the skew. Right? So the skew, just to remind folks, right, is the three-point correlation function connected. Right? So here's a distribution that you might be dealing with. Okay? It has a certain skew and a certain variance. In fact, of course, it has a whole tower of correlations. Okay? As you coarse grain, this flows to this line here. Right? And this distribution here flows to a zero skew. The path it takes might be complicated. Now, if you're interested in the skew, coarse graining will destroy all that information for you. Okay? So if you think somehow, for example, say you're an options pricing person. Yes?
Is it possible to choose your method of coarse graining so that you preserve what you're interested in?
Is it possible to choose your coarse grading mechanism so that you preserve the variables you're interested in? It may be the case that the variables you're interested in describing cannot be described by a universality class. So for example, let's say that somebody invented, please don't do this, a financial instrument, okay, that traded on the value of the three-point function of the stock market. Okay? So somehow you get a point and you make money if the skew of the stock market that week is plus one and you lose if it's minus one. Right, you're shaking your head. Okay, good, sorry, yeah. So, the central limit theorem now is no use to you. Right, because it tells you, all it tells you is that if you aggregate enough, that skew goes to zero. So you need to have a really particular knowledge of the stock market now, a very particular knowledge of the underlying mechanism in order to predict the value of the skew. Now, if you're lucky, you might have some great theory, okay, that actually does that. It says, oh, this is some kind of interesting phase transition, but in general, it's not necessarily going to work out that way. And so that, for example, means that you may not be able to build a Black-Scholes-like equation, an effective theory, for that variable that you're using. Okay. All right. So how do we coarse grain in a way other than simply adding things together and dividing by the total number? And this is a story that physicists examined for many, many years from different angles. What I'll tell you is I'll tell you the story that Leo Kadnov came up with. Leo Kadnov produced a story about coarse graining that is very intuitive. He didn't win the Nobel Prize because Kim Wilson came up with a story that was calculationally more powerful, but much harder to understand. You're often taught the Ken Wilson story, and much later you learn the Leo Kadnov story, and you wonder why it class is so hard. So, the way I first introduced this, we were talking at a meeting last year, we were talking about the mortgage crisis. And in talking about the mortgage crisis, a friend of mine said, well, you know, I was applying for a mortgage, and I was very lucky, because if anyone in my zip code had defaulted on their mortgage, I would either not be able to get one, or I'd get such a serious interest rate that I just couldn't do it. So I'm very lucky, okay. So the bank there, or the system of banks that awards mortgages, have an implicit coarse graining theory, okay. So what they say is if your neighborhood has one bad mortgage, the whole neighborhood is bad, okay. So imagine all these dots of houses here, right. And the houses can be in one of two states. They can either be successfully paying their mortgage or they can be in default for some reason, okay. If we have 64 houses, okay, there are 10 to the 19 possible states of the housing market. Okay? And of course, it's going to grow exponentially. What the bank tries to do, instead of having a detailed theory about, you know, your moral probity, is that they attempt to coarse grain your neighborhood. And instead of looking at your individual probability of defaulting or paying your mortgage, they coarse grain to, let's say, the zip code level. Okay? And so instead of, let's say, having 64 possible states, they group you into a little neighborhood, let's say, of four houses. Okay? And so what that means is that what used to be a pixel that required four variables to describe now requires only one. Okay? Now the exact way you summarize these four variables, okay, in terms of this new one, so sigma to sigma half, the exact way that you do that coarse graining operation, okay, that's magic. Right? So that's one question, is how do you coarse grain? What's the exact technique? So for example, the bank says, I'll take the min, right? So let's say default is minus one. So if anyone's defaulting here, my aggregate variable is minus one. Okay. Leo Tadnoff said, pick one, call it decimation, right? Just pick one at random. Okay? And make the sigma hat, okay, be the value of one of these things here chosen at random. The most natural one is to average. Just take the average value of all these four variables. Okay. And average the sigma hat one. So notice that we've thrown out information. Okay? So if you, for example, were building an agent-based model and you had an underlying mechanism that worked for houses, okay? Now we're talking about neighborhoods, you have fewer variables. Okay, you still have quite a lot, you have 16, but there's far fewer. And the price you paid, of course, is that now you don't have exact knowledge about the details of the city. Okay? So this is what happens in physics when you use this, it's called renormalization group flow. So this coarse graining operation here, where you go from 64 states to 16, by aggregating in terms of spatial proximity, is called renormalization. Let's say you have, in fact, you know that, let's say you have mass end theory. Not because max end theory is the only way to do science, but just because it's an easy one to describe. So you have a set of constraints in your max end theory. Okay? And let's say, for example, all you constrain is the overall energy. Okay? So this here, or the sum over I's and j's, this is what's going to go into your max end exponent. It's going to allow you to predict, okay, the distribution of the housing market. So I'll be really explicit because this is a crucial point. You're trying to predict, okay, the probability of a certain configuration of the housing market. You know, let us say, that it's described by a max end theory. Okay? And that's the distribution you get. Okay. Let's coarse grain that theory. And what might happen is the following. Okay? Now you're working with these reduced variables, sigma hats, instead of sigmas. Okay? And everything is the same. Everything is the same except for the value of the j parameter. Okay? That's changed by an overall multiplicative factor. Okay? If this happens, you're a happy person, and you call your theory renormalizable. So let's be really explicit. What does this mean? What does this process mean when you coarse grain from a 64-node system with some theory, and in this case you just cash it out as a max end theory? Okay? Now you go from talking about houses to talking about neighborhoods. Okay? Let's say you had a psychological theory of mortgage default that produced your set of parameters. Okay? So an individual in the house might look at his neighbor and say, well, my neighbor's not paying, he finds all stuff paying. If that theory is renormalizable, when you scale up to households, the same story goes through. So now instead of having people making decisions, you have sort of neighborhoods looking at each other and making decisions. You have this new effective particle, the household particle, okay, that has a set of interaction logic. Okay. You have an emergent description of the system that doesn't rely upon the things that you previously identified as the underlying fundamental microphysical constituents. Okay? So if a social theory is renormalizable, the way to put it is that a psychiatrist is a very good sociologist. Okay? Because all the psychiatrist has to do to describe a group is say, well, you know, groups are like people because the theory is renormalizable. I just have to change some of the parameters a little bit. Right? I just have to say, okay, well, you know, groups are like people, they're probably a little bit more neurotic. Right? And they probably don't, I don't know, have these kinds of emotions as much. But the same mechanisms go through. And in fact, there may even be a person who's like a group. A person who has the unusual parameters that the group does. Okay. Now let's aggregate his neurons in some way. Okay. So he has a description of 100 neurons. Let's aggregate them into a smaller number of effective neurons. Okay. Now let's try and make predictions about the behavior of those effective neurons. If neuroscience is renormalizable, okay, in order to make that prediction, I can have the same functional form of the theory, just with different parameters. In particular, I don't have to add higher order correlations into the theory by n. Right? And so that's what happens here. What could happen, and in general probably will happen, is that in order to make predictions about the coarse grain theory, not only do you have to change the parameters of the theory, but you also have to add new interactions.
I see. So within the context of prediction, if it's renormalizable, I can keep the model the same, and all I have to do is change, fit the parameters differently to get the same level of prediction. For
exactly, yeah. Okay. But if the theory is not renormalizable, I have new emergent interactions. Okay. So in this case here, I've gone from what you might call fine-grained theory to a more coarse-grained theory. Right? And the question is, what happens when you make that transition? This is, if you're a physicist, this is backwards from how it's usually done. Usually you go from the coarse-grained theory and zoom in. Okay, but the story is the same. So here's, yes? So let's consider the max n theories because it's a nice, it's a convenient example, right? Given this theory, I can predict all the moments, right? Because I have the probability distribution over all possible states in the system. So I can compute not only the variance, but I can compute the kurtosis and, you know, anything I'd like. I can compute the entropy. Right? So this is a complete description of the system, right? And, you know, in this case, the theory is particularly simple. It's just pairwise interaction theory. And the question is, in order to get a complete description of the reducing system, right, can I work with the same parameters? Yes?
So when I look at this and I see sort of the normalizable, it just it comes off to me a little bit like sort of stereotyping, but you're essentially stereotyping these groups in a certain way, and based on the average or based on whatever. And I guess when I think of social processes, I always think that human agency really matters. Mm-hmm. And
This is a really great question, and we're on opposite sides. Let me tell you why the side I'm on seems to make sense to me. Right? We're totally immersed in emergent phenomena. I was trying to think of a cute introduction to do. I remember when I was in college, I had to read a book of poems, and it suddenly struck me that this was totally absurd. Right? Why were they so obsessed by this thing? We're just animals. Right? Where do all these rules come from? Why do we have rules about what makes a good poem? Why am I stressed about getting a good grade in this class? Right? Where do those emergent phenomena come from? Now, I would say they come from the coarse graining of human agency. I'm, in that sense, a reductionist, right? All of the rules of poetry, all of my anxieties about doing well in a college class, right? They all come from the coarse graining of lots of people making decisions. Now, that process may be totally mysterious, right? But I still believe that process goes through. There is this sort of one way out of that description that maybe you're getting at with the Holocaust story, the great man theory, right, is that what if there's some kind of perturbation, okay? One of the values of one of these sigmas here is sufficiently large that it kind of blows everything away. And in fact, the theory can kind of account for that. If it's a particular person, no, right? So a coarse-grained theory of emergent social phenomena will not allow you to pinpoint who's Hitler, right, unfortunately, right? In the same way, in this case, you can't pinpoint either which way it's going to fold or the exact microphysical structure it's going to cause it to break in one way or another. So those are sort of two answers. One is that I think that any good scientific theory of social systems has to, in some sense, describe how we scale up. Right? The other thing is this, the influence of sort of these rare events. And I mean, it's a crucial thing, right? As people talk about, well, maybe the stock market is fundamentally unpredictable because of these rare events. Now, the story of universality allows you to explain a little bit about why that might be the case if the underlying mechanism has a certain set of properties, and yes, it is unpredictable. Right? Or if it's non-ergodic, we just can't predict it because it's shifting in a certain way. So I don't know if that's a constellation of answers to your question. It's a really deep question. Sandra, you can
take it. Yeah, you drew a finite system, very finite.
Mm-hmm.
The renormalization grouped our arguments are you not thinking of very large systems? In some sense that we scale to the cells and so on. Mm-hmm. Where if you bring in maybe the boundary effects, of course, then all these things become very complicated. I think that's what I'm asking.
Well, Sandra, you're a person much better than I, but let me give an answer to that. Let's say you're coarse-graining in the central limit theorem. Okay, so you have some distribution, and it has some value of the skew. So if you measure a single value, that distribution has a strong skew. As you average more and more and more, you approach this universal point, the Gaussian. Right? The question is maybe I need 10 to the 32 measurements to get to a point where the skew is zero, or very close to zero. And the approach to this might be slow. And in the same way, it might be the case that even though the mechanism, let's say, of the housing market is a member of a certain universality class, I just don't have a set of neighborhoods that's large enough to reach that point. And this often gets to be a problem because you don't have as many orders of magnitude to scale over. Yeah, you know these things, but it's a fun question, right? It's a very important point, and one of the things that you can spend a lot of time thinking about, it's a very interesting question, is what happens, okay, so here you're doomed, right? If you're trying to get a universal description of a theory, you only have two averages, and nothing's going to work, right? You need a specific description about the point, right? But as you get closer to this point, you get something called finite size scaling, okay? And so you can ask how quickly and in what regime am I approaching that universal point of the system? And in some situations, not only is the final end state of the coarse graining process universal, but so is the way in which you approach that final point. So you can also get some traction there, right? So for example, you might imagine looking not only at the distribution of programming projects, just a second here, not only the distribution of software projects over the course of 10 years, but you might look at smaller scale studies. So you might look, for example, at the distribution of languages used in, let's say, scientific programming. Or you might try to coarse grain by time and look at the distribution of software languages in a particular month and ask, how am I approaching, let us say, okay, the log normal is the correct description, how am I approaching, okay, that log normal distribution? David?
Yeah, so I was just trying to get, so if you're a reductionist, is that effectively like saying that all theories to you are renormalized?
No. There's a paper we'll put on the reading list by Phil Anderson, right? There's sort of two kinds of reductionism, right? One is that it's sort of the trivial reductionism that I'm not going to portray very well. But the other one, which I think is a much softer version, simply says that, yes, like every emergent phenomenon we see is the outcome of processes on a finer grain scale. And I can't imagine another kind of emergence philosophers would try. Right, so some people might say, well, clearly there's no consciousness in the firing of neurons, and yet we know my brain is just aggregations of neurons, so there must be some new magical thing that sort of flies in at some level of coarse graining and drops off some consciousness. I don't buy that, but that would be an introduction standpoint. If renormalization fails, all it means is that the details matter all the way up, right? That the particular value of the skew matters, okay? That would be the case if renormalization fails. Yes, sir.
Yes. So, if I can add to the comment that goes back to the Hitler story. So, what happens, and also it relates to the reduction. So, you coarse grain, and then you study the dynamics of the course of the variable, or whatever you call the coarse grain.
Uh-huh.
But then, what happens in, well, for sure, in metallurgical system and most likely metallurgical systems, that these things have their own dynamics. This feedback on the single input, right? So, what I'm saying is that if you look at the distribution that comes out, that's a coarse grain property, that's a mesoscale, if you want, property. Mm-hmm. But how does this feedback on the choice of individuals?
Think about the black, here's an example. Think about the Black-Scholes equation, right? So let's just say Black-Scholes works. People make money off it. Now, maybe they make money because they pay people off, but say they make money off it for legitimate reasons. say the Black-Scholes equation, right? The bargain that it makes says their interest rates or growth rates are drawn from some distribution, and they're reasonably independent, so you coarse-grain this limiting distribution, right? Okay. Now, in general, the idea, the sort of underlying theory of Black-Scholes, is that you're the only guy who's using Black-Scholes, right? Okay. You're the only guy who's using it, and so you have some sort of really sort of enormous system of experience that you have no effect over, and you're making decisions based on it. Now, if everyone's using Black-Scholes, okay, it's a different world, right? Now, potentially, all of the assumptions, for example, the independence of draws from the interest rates, that might collapse, okay? So if everyone uses Black-Scholes, it might fail, right? But that's simply because the mechanism now is more complicated. So I think you can account for those kinds of stories, right? The stories where, yes, I'm observing the distribution and trying to cash in on features of the distribution, but so is everyone else, right? What that does is it makes the system more complicated. It changes the mechanism. But it doesn't necessarily make it unamenable to scientific description, although that may not be what you were suggesting. Okay, of course, yeah. But that's what happens. Think about the language case. Why am I going to program in Python? Right? Well, presumably, I'm not just making that, I'm not making that decision independently of everyone else. Right? I'm observing other features of the system, so my choice to learn Python versus Ruby is governed by my observation of the average state of the system. And in fact, if you look at GitHub, they even tell you what languages people are using. So there's already this coupling, right?
There in this sense, it's like individuals, so the fine grain, know already what the higher level, or what the something about the coarse grain level.
Absolutely, yeah.
This in biological cases and it's not even necessary. I mean, I'm not saying it doesn't happen, it doesn't ever happen, but it's not necessary.
It's not necessary.
Or sometimes it doesn't.
Let me give you one further answer, and then we can take this up, because I think it's a deeper set of questions that we can deal with. But let's say I have the relationship between two coarse-grain variables, which of course we do, right? This theory here is talking about the relationship not between people, but between neighborhoods, right? So if you were to tell a story, it'd be like neighborhoods making decisions. Right? And so that's what renormalization allows you to do, in a sense. It allows you to even stop talking about individuals altogether when you talk about the large-scale dynamics. And if you find a good coarse-grain description, it might have a very weird way of aggregating, and we'll see this in the next lecture, aggregating over the fine-grain properties. Right? So in fact, the boundaries of the coarse-grain object might cut individual needs. Okay. Anyway, well that's a sort of deeper question, but we'll get to it.
May I make one question? Of this whole issue. Is it true that you would agree with me if I say the following? Somewhere the renormalization group idea is successful most when there is some kind of scale invariance already. If you think of a system which has a strong structural hierarchy, for example, quarks, then there is in between, say, nuclei and then atoms. These are structurally very different, which would mean that it's very hard to coarse grain from the quarks up to the atoms, because there is a real structural in between. And that, I think, was also a remark made by Anderson a little bit. That he said, you reach the structural, and then there is an intermediate structural field you have to coarse grain again or something. What is your feeling about?
Well, so let me just tell an explicit story, right? So, let's say we coarse grain, the theory gets more complicated. This is exactly what happens in the quark case. Okay. So, at the beginning of this talk, I said, oh, you can do a simulation, either agent-based models or lattice QCD. Well, lattice QCD is how people try to model quarks. Okay. So, let's say that when you coarse grain, you've got all of these new interactions. Right? Neighborhoods were not only looking at each other, but they were behaving in group-like ways that the underlying people didn't. Right? Okay? So that's kind of crazy, but another way to put it is this. You may have a complicated theory of neighborhoods, but when you scale back down, it gets reasonable. So that's what happens in lattice QCD, is asymptotic freedom. So, in some sense, renormalization, if you start telling this story, one direction is better than another, often. Now, it can be the case that one parameter gets large and then gets small, and different ones in different directions. Let me just, since we're running out of time for this lecture. This is a formal diagram. Probably we can skip over, except let me just draw a little bit of the story here. So in that top plane there, okay, you have a theory that has two parameters. Okay? These arrows here, you flow as you coarse-grain the system. You flow to different values of those parameters. Okay? So this is a large-scale picture of the kind of renormalization story we've been telling. Okay? And in general, these arrows here, how you coarse-grain in the physical world, generally since we live in space-time and our theories are about space and time, we coarse-grain by aggregating on increasingly larger or smaller spatial scales. Let me skip over this. We can talk about this a little bit later. Let me also skip the question of universality at the critical point. Okay? We can talk about that somewhere. So, here's what you have. You have a particular underlying mechanism. So Chris Moore introduced the IC model, am I correct? Did he show you simulations of the IC model? Yes, they're great. So we'll do some more simulations of them on Tuesday. So the IC model is a set of underlying mechanisms, right? As you remember, for let's say Glauber dynamics or Trompe's Hastings algorithm, you can talk about spins choosing whether or not to flip based on the behavior of their neighbors. Okay? And when you aggregate that system on increasingly larger and larger scales, you can talk about the average magnetization of the system. Okay? You have an underlying parameter here, t. Okay? So think of t as like, say, the variance, right? It's some underlying feature of the system, you can turn that knob. It's like the strength of the coupling between the arrows. Okay? And if you coarse grain on increasingly large scales, when you go from here, actually in this case, this is the overall external field, but if you coarse grain the system increasingly, you get the following thing. Below a certain critical value, okay, of the coupling constant, t, okay, when you coarse grain, the average magnetization is zero. Okay? But at a certain critical point, okay, the system has to pick one state, either the up state or the down state. So this is exactly analogous here. Okay? So in this case, the temperature parameter is how hard I'm pushing down. At some point, it has to pick, okay, an up phase or a down phase. And this phase transition, okay, the behavior of this magnetization parameter is exactly the same as what happens in a totally different system. Okay, in this case, the mixture of liquid and gas at the critical point. Okay? The ordered parameter is different. What you're measuring is not the overall magnetization, but rather the density of the system. And what happens is, at a certain critical point, the system either goes to an all-gas or an all-liquid phase. Okay? And that happens at a certain critical value. So we can describe the features of these two systems that have completely different underlying dynamics, completely different underlying mechanisms. In some sense, the IC model doesn't even exist, right? It's just some simulation set of computer. But it has exactly the same dynamics as the transition between vapor and liquid. I see a skeptical frown in the back. Let me give you a preview of renormalization of biological systems. Go ahead. So let's consider the liquid-gas phase, right? If you move too far away, okay, in temperature, then eventually you'll discover, for example, the existence of solids, right? And there's no such thing in the case of the IC model. So if you move too far away in parameter space, when you coarse grain, you get sucked off to some new area. Okay. So let me give you a preview. Renormalization by aggregation of spatial scales doesn't really work in biological systems, right? One thing that does tend to work is renormalization, okay, on the scale of time. So let's say we have a sequence of observations, alpha 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay? So these are measured at different times, second 1, second 2. Okay? We can produce a description of the system average, okay, on increasingly larger and larger time scales. Okay? And that will be a way in which you might choose to coarse grain a biological system. You, of course, have to specify exactly the way you do that averaging, sort of decimation rule. Okay? I put up a reference to Dan Rothman's work because there's many different ways to do it. The obvious one is if they're real numbers, just average them. Okay? And that's exactly what we did, what we do, when we look at timescales in a biological system. What we're asking here is, what are the signatures as you average on increasingly larger and larger scales? Okay? And what you see is, as you aggregate, instead of looking at the finest grain time scales, you aggregate on increasingly larger and larger scales, you see novel phenomena emerge. Okay? That's not the whole story. The problem is that when you come to construct these biological explanations, you rely not only on aggregating in time, which is a way, for example, to look at the spectrum of fluctuations, but you also aggregate in terms of what you might call functional equivalence classes. So in that paper, when we come to make descriptions of the system, when we come to make biological arguments, we look not only on how the system behaves when you coarse-grain it in time, but also how the system behaves when you look at groups of individuals or subgroups within the system as a single unit. So here, for example, we had a nice story about what happens if all you do is look at the time scales of fluctuations, how the system coarse-grains, when you restrict a particular subclass of animals to be identified not by their spatial proximity, as would be the case in the physical system, but by the functional roles they play. Okay. This is the large problem. And this is the problem we'll talk about in the second lecture, the problem of renormalization in inhomogeneous systems. So what you do here, you take the nearest neighbors in the physical system. And why that works is sort of a profound fact that physicists don't really think about. What we do know is that biological systems look like this. They look like networks that don't have clear ways to find nearest neighbor averaging rules that make sense. Okay. So let me just scroll through sort of a cartoon picture of what happens. So this is the classic text in quantum field theory. And in quantum field theory, you spend a lot of time doing these coarse-graining arguments. Because it's a way, in fact, to produce predictions from a system where you don't know the underlying microphysics. Okay? We have mechanisms in the social sciences as well. We talk about interactions between individuals. Okay? And in some sense, they're equivalent to interactions between particles. The problem is that when we come to coarse-grain the physical system, we know what to do, okay? But when we come to coarse-grain the biological system, we know that this kind of thing doesn't work. If you want to understand why animals are behaving the way they do in some pen, you don't get an increasingly powerful telescope to zoom in on, you know, exactly the hairs on the back of a monkey, okay? But of course, this is exactly what you do in physics, right? The reason you build the super collider at CERN is because you want to look at increasingly smaller and smaller scales and confirm the effective theories we know are true at larger scales and potentially find new mechanisms. Okay? And the way we do that is we look at increasingly small scales. Okay? But that's not how explanations are going to work in biology. In general, actually, we often have access to the most fine-grained description of the system we could ever want. Right? So, for example, in the case of the animals, we know exactly what all the animals were doing. Okay? Physicists never have that information. They have no way to know the exact position of all compartments, or the distribution of the position of all compartments. So we have the fine-grained information. The question is, how do we scale up? How do we go from knowing the facts about these animals to knowing facts about the social system of which they're a part? Yes?
Just taking that sentence, we do have a smaller scale that is neural information.
We do, yes. Yes, so neural information is interesting because we have complete but partial information. We have exact knowledge of spike trains. We just don't have exact knowledge of all the spike trains.
Okay. But in theory, there's a smaller scale of interaction.
Yes, I see what you're saying. Yes, that is true. In general, when we start with the animals, we want to scale up to the larger system. When we start with the neurons, we want to scale up to the consciousness. We tend not to want to go the other way. Although sometimes people do go the other way, so they'll say, what are the neural correlates of attentionless?
Yeah, well, obviously, neural activation coordinates mediated ways
between people's interactions. Yes, and that becomes a scaling up story, right? You have the fine-grained information, all the neural firings, and you're trying to scale it up to some large correlation between animals and their behavior.
Or
if you
start from social behavior, you're scaling down by looking at not just the interaction of individuals, but mm-hmm. also the interaction itself. Neural activation within brains and between brains.
Yes. One of the things that happens is as you coarse grain, information about the fine grain scales tends to disappear. So, in talking to you, I generally have no idea about your neural activation. If fact, I have very little idea about the underlying mechanisms of how you think at all, which is why I have the problem that you might be able to hear. Right? So oftentimes, you're ignorant of the fine-grained properties. What physicists try to do is, even though the fine-grained properties tend to disappear in the coarse grain, if you have really accurate measurements, you can detect them. So that would be the analog there might be looking at your reaction times and trying to figure out something about the internal dynamics of potassium and sodium in your neural system. Right? I need really accurate information for that. And that tends not to happen in social sciences, which is, I think, why we tend to scale up more than we do the physics story of trying to zoom in by getting more and more precise machines. So, yes, John?
So I just found myself thinking about this framework in the context of asking questions about the world, right? Because, you know, and on the one hand, if renormalization works, then it almost seems to be saying, well, given this filter, this model, I get pretty much the same type of answer to this question across whatever scale, right? Whereas it seems like in studying social phenomena, we might say, well, I have this question, and presumably on certain scales for a given model, I'm not going to get a meaningful answer at all. The output is not going to be predictive. It's not going to provide, you know, convergence to certain statistics. And presumably, if you're trying to look at an idea of emergence, that maybe at some scale, there's a critical scale beyond which my model then begins to supply predictions for descriptive statistics.
That's fair, yes.
Yeah, I'm just kind of, because I guess what's different in physics is we have the intuitive experience of the coarse-grained reality that we can kind of test our theories against. Mm-hmm. And then we have the kind of perplexing quantum mechanic world.
Yes.
And it seems like we have these nice bounds that we kind of know, but in a lot of the phenomena, be it complex behavior, social systems, there's kind of this vague point where, you know, when do our questions start becoming answerable?
Yeah, no, I think this is a very fair point. And I think my sense is that you're getting at this question of, you have your specific microtheory, at what point does it coarse-grain sufficiently, let us say, that the details disappear and you make an overall prediction?
Yeah.
Which is, how fast do you get from here to there, and are the phenomena you want to explain all the way down here? And it's a good question, right? The speed at which you converge to that limiting distribution can be very important. There are some systems where it just happens too slowly. So we work in a system where the scale is the logarithm of the logarithm of the number of particles. And that goes so slowly that, yes, the limit of infinite particles, it gets there. But for any finite-sized system, you're so far away from that sort of universal point, you can't make predictions. And that can completely happen, in which case, ideas say, well, we can't really talk about emergent phenomena under the scheme we described here. All we can do is write simulations, right, and look at their outputs and feel that we understand it because we put in the mechanism and magic happens inside the machine. And some people might say, well, that's completely satisfying, I want to do that. Other people might say, that's not how I feel like I want to build explanations.
Well, isn't that kind of to say that maybe your question is posed in such a way that you can get a satisfactory answer, but not on a satisfactory timescale? You haven't matched your question to your timescale of interest.
It could be. I mean, I'm trying to think of a really specific example that brings it down to earth. I mean, think about, for example, you're trying to explain a social phenomenon backed by institutions. Well, if you're at the wrong scale, if you're too close in, then the reason this business failed was this guy was kind of a bad guy. You know, like very detailed narrative explanations. Okay, so that's the wrong scale to expect a scientific description to emerge. Right? All you can really do, maybe you have a science, you have a psychological science that you can simulate the failure of that business, but you can't come up with an effective theory because all the details still matter. If you can get to a scale where it does work, I mean, let me give you one reason to think that it might work, let's say, in neuroscience. We have an effective theory for neuroscience already. It's folk psychology. I can predict what you're going to do, or try to predict what you're going to do, based on coarse-grained descriptions of your internal state. Like you're happy, or you're tired, or you're curious. And given that, I have a theory. So there are these kind of emergent, coarse-grained descriptions that work, or at least work reasonably well. Now, you can make the argument they don't work at all. You can say folk psychology is actually not predictive at all. We just pretended it, we read it. So that's one thing. But if you say that we actually can predict things about what we're going to do, then maybe there is a reason to believe that we can scale from neural level up.
So I'm going to play devil's advocate. I think with social processes, like for instance, if you go back to your original example of like revolutions or, you know, protests. So if you look at like Tahrir Square in Egypt, I think political science protest or revolution, some sort of major phenomenon in Egypt for the last 30 years. Mm-hmm. Right? And so I think really the question for a lot of political scientists was when. And I wonder if these like coarse-grained models can really give me that answer, because I feel like it's not necessarily the question of, you know, will it happen, but exactly when will it happen. And
so let me answer that. Let me give you the angel's position. You're the devil's advocate. No theory is going to tell you the date of a revolution. And it's not going to tell you the name of the person who started it, the name of, who showed up there on that day. It's possible that a good theory can tell you a distribution, right? So, again, when I'm pushing on this, right, and it collapses, no one can tell you exactly when it's going to collapse. But they can give you a distribution. They can say, look, it's not going to take a year for this to fold. It's not going to happen in a microsecond, right? So if you understand some of the fluctuations of all this, is a bit of a non-equilibrium question, if we get to the third question. But you may not be able to predict the date, but you might be able to predict, let's say, the time scale for it. So I'm not sure if that's helpful. It's also, of course, no one has such a theory. So I'm just arguing for the sort of a priori plausibility of the theory existing, right? So it's up to somebody to construct it. And of course, it may not be possible. It may not be possible for a lot of reasons, including, for example, the fact that the system is fundamentally non-normalized. Right? So the only thing you would assume is it. Yes, Graham?
Since time keeps coming up, could you go back a couple slides to your statement on why climate seems to be a poor question in this one?
Yeah, sure. So Graham asked, why does time, why if spatial structure, if coarse graining based on spatial proximity doesn't work, why does coarse graining on sort of temporal proximity work? Right? So just to be clear, it's pretty clear to me that if we go into the system with the animal system, which you've heard about on and off over the course of the summer, you go back to that system, if we try to build a theory about which animals are nearby each other, we're not going to get a very good theory. Because the effective theory, the coarse-grained variables, are aggregations of functional classes, not spatial classes. Okay? My influence on others is not determined by my spatial proximity to them in a sophisticated species. In the time case, yes, let me finish. In the time case, it tends to work out that events that are close to each other or nearby each other often are associated with each other. Okay. Now, that's not a scientific argument, and what it just basically means is, in general, it's reasonable to expect that it will work, and it's worth trying. That's why we tried it. Now, it may be the case that events that are close together in time are not associated, right? So trading on the stock market, right? Individual trades the exact moments which they go in. That proximity is not important, right? But in the system here, where everyone can see each other, they're sort of synchronized to the same kind of rhythm, okay? It's plausible to believe that that temporal aggregation works. It's only plausible, then you go and see if it actually works out. So, I mean, just to go to your own work, right, it's maybe not, it could be the case, but let's just say, for argument's sake, that where the publishing house is located, if you coarse grain on that, it's probably not going to be that informative, right? But if you coarse grain on the year in which the novels are published, okay, maybe that's actually a better aggregate class, right, as opposed to the street addresses of the publishing house. You wanted to follow up? Yes. Yes, quickly.
So I start with right, because I think spatial aggregation and this kind of thing are the most important, but it's kind of visible. So if you take your experiment, space or a spatial structure, you cannot see that because you're taking too little space into account. But too little space into account compared to how information spread.
Yes, absolutely. Right. Yes.
So spatial structure is not regular, it depends on where you look.
I think that's very fair. Yeah. But notice there what's happening is that the reason that the spatial structure becomes a good coarse-graining variable is because time already is.
Yes, well. So in a sense, what you get eventually to is a sort of speed of light, which
absolutely, speed of information, absolutely. So this came up in some work we were doing on Afghanistan, right? What's the speed of information flow? If it's mule, it's sort of 5 kilometers an hour or whatever mule travels at. But if it's a cell phone tower, you can communicate instantaneously. And so that's going to change your spatial coarse-graining levels. And there, it's sort of, the idea is that things that are accurate, things that are close in time, right, are also close in space. Well, that's why. Yeah, but I mean, it's a very good point. And of course, in many situations, for example, flocks, coarse-graining spatially, like a bird flock, presumably you can get a very good description where you coarse-grain spatially. Exactly. Yeah.
So with any, you can like start this hierarchy and of the scale for the coarse grain. But that hierarchy.
So in the case where you're aggregating on spatial scales, right, the hierarchy is just sort of your resolution. Like you kind of blur everything out. Right? And so there's a whole bunch of structure here, I blur it into one big thing. So then that hierarchy is approximately continuous, right? I don't feel like I'll go from one level to the next, right? Although in the case, for example, of the aggregated neighborhoods, in that case, there is a discrete sort of house to neighborhood level. Oftentimes, that knob that you turn is continuous. When you come to coarse grain on functional class, then there really is a discrete hierarchy, right? I look at individuals, and then I might look, for example, at the coarse grain group of all young females or all young males and try to build descriptions about the interaction between those two. Right. And there it really does feel like I have one fine-grained level and then just we jump to the next one.
Sorry, what I meant was that you're looking at time and then you're looking at functional.
Yes.
But you're saying that the most important scale that you're, item on which you're coarse grading is the time. Mm-hmm. And then you have to look at coarse grading on the functional.
Oh, I see what you're saying, yes. So this is a very good point. In fact, this doesn't really come up in physics because we only have one thing in coarse grain, that's spatial clustering. We coarse grain spatially. So it's like we have one direction we can flow in. But when you have biological systems, there's many directions that you can coarse grain on. So you can coarse grain in time, but not coarse grain on the names of the individuals. Or you don't coarse grain on time, you coarse grain functional categories that way. Or you use some both at the same time. There's different directions you can go, there's different coarse graining operations you can do, right? And that's actually a very nice point. It's a very different system than you, it's a very different situation than you have in physics, where there's only one thing you do, and that's just average on increasing larger and larger spatial scales. So, thank you.
As a continuation to that comment, is it possible that the choice of this function or the way in which you coarse grain, mm-hmm. can it make the same system renormalizable in some sense, and in other ways not
being
normalized?
So yes. So you can. There are better and worse ways to coarse grain, right? So here's a really bad way to coarse grain. For example, it might be take the extreme value, right, of your sequence to get the sigma hat, right? And you might worry there that coarse graining operation is now going to be super sensitive to fluctuations on the fine grain scale, so it's not going to go away, right? So there are bad ways to coarse grain. In physics, in general, it doesn't really matter as long as you don't do something dumb. In biology, I think the question, in social sciences, the question becomes much harder because you want to coarse grain on the right scale so that you have theories that are simple. And what simple theories mean, in this case, we normalize them so they don't have enormous numbers of adjustable parameters that you have to do. So just to go ahead, we'll finish, but let me just make one last point, right? So when we did the statistics lecture, I grouped people by sex and I grouped people by people. Right, so I coarse-grained the system, and I looked for overall interaction, gender-gender, and gender-field, and field-field. Right? I didn't find anything. Okay? That doesn't mean there's nothing to be found in the interaction with students. It just means I didn't pick a particularly interesting way to coarse-grain the system. So, anyway, thank you very much. It's gone off, but I really appreciate the question.